have, on one hand, the world of geometric theories, which is a logical world, if you want. Yesterday we defined a theory as a geometric theory as a set of axioms of a particular form within first order logic. And on the other hand, we have growth and deep topos. Categories of sheets on a site. And the classifying topos construction allows to make these two words in communication with each other, thanks to the fact that during geometric theory one can associate a growth and deep topos, which yesterday we saw that we one can build this topos in a completely canonical way, starting from T, by first taking this is the standard construction. You take the syntactic site of the theory, and then the topos of sheets on this syntactic site satisfies the universal property of the classifying topos of the theory. I recall this fundamental property. It means that the geometric morphisms from any growth and deep topos E to this classifying topos are in categorical equivalence with the models of the theory in the topos E, naturally in E. So this basically means that we have a particular mathematical world, in some sense, this is the classifying topos, which contains a particular model of the theory, which we can call UT, which is the model that corresponds to the identity here. If you take E equal to the classifying topos, then of course you have the identical geometric morphism here. And so to this, it corresponds a particular model of the theory inside the classifying topos. And this model that we call UT is universal in the sense that all the other models of the theory in other toposes, here we can, for instance, take the topos of sets or whatever topos, all the other models can be obtained from this universal model by applying the inverse image functor of a geometric morphism, which is in fact uniquely determined by the model. This is a UNIDA argument, because this means representability, as we remarked yesterday, of the pseudo functor of the models of the theory.
So you consider morphisms of models or isomorphisms of models, that is T model of A.
Ah no, here the morphisms are homomorphisms, structure homomorphisms. I take this as arrows.
Yeah, and this corresponds then to morphisms of,
yes.
Of yeah. Between...
This corresponds to, yesterday we saw that there was an intermediate step to prove this, which was through the Cartesian JT continuous functors, like this. And so, in fact, I didn't explain this yesterday because of lack of time, but when you but the natural transformations here correspond to the morphisms of models in the sense of sigma structure homomorphism. So you have that. And then from this to that, it is completely standard.
Yeah, but in I don't know what the convention is, but in Grothendieck, as you referred, the morphism of between two toposes form a category. And the home between F and G is home between F lower star and G lower star, so it reverses the direction.
No, but it is the same thing as also in the other direction. They are in bijective correspondence. So instead of
here the model is obtained by applying F after star.
Yes, of course, so but instead of taking the morphisms here, you don't necessarily have to take the direct image to define them. You can take as...
It's an adjoint.
So you can... define it in this way, so alternatively.
Ah,
so yes, it's the same.
So this gives in some opposition relative to Grothendieck.
Yeah, of course.
It's not exact, okay.
Yeah, so I was drawing here this picture just to show that whatever model you want to consider
of the theory inside any topos, in particular in the topos of set, will be the image of this universal model under some...
UT is what you call it. MT?
No, yesterday MT was inside the syntactic category. What you have to do to get UT starting from MT, you just apply UNIDA. Because, this topology, this syntactic topology is subcanonical, so you have UNIDA embedding here. And so you can... So here, we had defined the model here, actually. So UT is just the image of this model there. And so what you get is that this M will be isomorphic to UT, and N will be isomorphic to UT, etc. So this picture shows you that basically this is a sort of a center of symmetry of the theory, because everything that happens elsewhere, in some sense, is a deformation of something that happens here at this core, in which, in some sense, the syntax and the semantics of the theory meet. Because let us recall that in this universal model, whatever is valid is whatever is provable in the theory. So you have this strong completeness that is realized by this model. Okay, so this is just repeating things from yesterday.
Sorry, just one question.
Yes.
If I understand correctly, this UT is actually an object.
Well, not really an object, because it depends. It is a collection of objects for each sort that you have. So if you have just a one-sorted language, you will get one object. If you have a many-sorted object, this will assign to each sort of the signature of the theory. So for each sort, you will have an object, you see? But in general, you can have many sorts, so you don't have just one object. It is a model. So a model is a bunch of...
For modules, for instance, you have a model for the ring and a model for the module.
Well, it depends if you want to keep the ring fixed or not. If you want to make the so if you want to make the ring variable, of course, then the natural thing to do is to choose to have two sorts. Yes. Okay. So now, since we have this assignment, a very natural question to ask is this sort of subjective or injective? So yesterday we already gave an answer concerning essential subjectivity, because we observed that every Grothendieck topos is actually the classifying topos of some theory, even though, of course, and it is a very important aspect on which the bridge technique is based, this is by no means canonical, in the sense that if you want to find a theory classified by a certain topos, you have necessarily to choose a particular way of representing that topos, and so you have by no means a canonical choice. In particular, this means that, so yesterday we saw that by choosing a site for the topos, a site of definition for the topos, so given a topos like that, one could write down a theory associated to this site, which formalizes J continuous flat functors on C, and which therefore, by the connexus equivalence, is classified by this topos. But as you can see here, we had to make a choice, we had to choose a site, and of course, a phenomenon that occurs very frequently is that you can represent a topos in many different ways. So there is this essential element of non-canonicity, which shouldn't be seen as a disadvantage of the theory, quite the opposite, in fact, because it means that the theory is extremely flexible and, in particular, capable of unifying different mathematical contexts, different mathematical theories, which share a common semantical core. Because actually, now we have understood subjectivity, but then we wonder if to which extent this assignment is, say, injective, in the sense that when is it the case that we have an equivalence between the classifying toposes of two different theories. Of course, remember that since classifying toposes are defined by means of a universal property, they are not strictly determined, but they are determined only up to categorical equivalence. So when I say that two theories are the same classifying topos, I actually mean that you have a categorical equivalence between them. This is just a classical notion of categorical equivalence. So you see the two toposes as categories, and then the notion is the usual one. So you wonder, when is it the case that this happens? The definition, the fundamental...
You don't keep the model when you say that. You just look at the abstract topos.
Yes, because the model depends on the signature. Sure. So in particular, we want to be able to compare theories that are written over different signatures. So of course, there are some situations where you want, for instance, the universal model of one theory to be sent to another. We shall see the case of subtoposes. In this case, you will see that the associated shift functor will send the universal model of a certain theory to the universal model of a quotient. So there are situations in which there are these correspondences, but in general, no. So what is the... we give a definition. T and T prime are said to be Morita equivalent if this happens, if they have equivalent classifying topposes. This is a standard definition. It is not me that invented the term Morita equivalence. And of course there is a reason for this name, because it actually generalizes the classical notion of Morita equivalence of rings. You say that, you say that two rings are Morita equivalent when the categories of left modules over them are equivalent. And it turns out that you can formalize this, we shall see it later. But just to say that this is really a strict generalization of the notion of Morita equivalence, the classical one. Okay, this means that we can identify Grothendieck toposes with geometric theories considered up to Morita equivalence. And so the bridges that I would like to talk about are precisely about the possibility of using the common classifying topos that two theories might share together as a sort of bridge for transferring things from one to another. And this transfer, I anticipate, will be made by considering invariants, categorical invariants that apply to toposes, so here at this level, and looking at how these invariants express in terms of the two theories related by the equivalence. Now, what makes this technique interesting is the fact that, in general, the notion of Morita equivalence is strictly weaker than the classical notion of bi-interpretability that you had in logic. So, bi-interpretability essentially means that you have a dictionary for translating formulas in the language of the first theory into formulas in the language of the second, in a way that this induces an equivalence at the semantic level. So there are many, many examples of theories that are not bi-interpretable, but that are Morita equivalent. So in those situations, you don't have a dictionary, so you cannot perform a direct translation between the two theories, but still, the fact that the two theories share the same classifying topos means that they have a lot in common with each other, and the only sensible way to make the transfer between them, or at least the most technically effective way, is really to take this common classifying topos and use it as a bridge through this invariant consideration.
In particular, they have the same models of sets.
Yes, I will also discuss the relationship between the fact of having the same set-based models with this more, but we shall come back to this later. So for the moment, I would like to just illustrate the fact that this connection between geometric theories and classifying topos is a very natural one. Well, in some sense, we would like that natural constructions that we can perform on one hand they give rise to natural constructions in the other world. So we would like, for instance, natural logical constructions that we wanted to perform on theories to translate into interesting geometric
operations that we might want to do on that topos. So to illustrate the fact that actually this correspondence is extremely natural, because for instance, by working with topos and making operations on classifying topos, then when you look at these operations from the point of view of theories, you often find things that are very interesting. I will start with a very simple invariant notion, which is the notion of subtopos, and I will describe how this notion expresses in terms of logic, so which is the logical counterpart of the notion of the subtopos. So here is a result, which I proved in my thesis. So if we have a geometric theory, then the subtoposes of its classifying topos are in natural bijection with the quotients. I will explain what I mean by this. Of C considered after syntactic equivalence. Okay, so I need to give some definitions because I don't. Well, André Joyer talked about subtoposes, but let's just recall the definition. So, what is a subtopos of a certain topos? It is simply what is also called the geometric inclusion. So, it is a geometric morphism such that its direct image is full and faithful. And what is a quotient of a geometric theory? Well, it is simply a theory which is obtained from the given theory just by adding more axioms while remaining over the same signature. So you don't change the signature, you just add more axioms. And what is a syntactic equivalence? Well, it is the relation that identifies two theories over the same signature when they prove exactly the same geometric sequence over the
signature. To change the signature so much, the theory remains the same.
Yes, exactly. I mean, it is the obvious thing that you want. Because, of course, I mean, if you add the things that are provable, the models do not change. So you certainly cannot expect this to hold. And so this bijection works in the following way. So when you have a quotient a quotient T prime, here you will have the universal property of the classifying topos of T, which gives this. And then you can write something analogous for T prime. And basically you have here a commutative diagram where here you compose with this inclusion given by the subtopos. So in particular the domain of the subtopos will be a classifying topos of the quotient. So you can localize everything in a most natural way. Okay, so how does this work? Well, the proof is not particularly difficult. I will just give the idea. We just use the representation, the syntactic representation that we gave of the classifying topos of the theory. So let's recall this. You take sheaves on the syntactic side, and you use the fact that the notion of subtopos admits a very natural site characterization. When I say site characterization, I mean a way to describe this invariant in terms of a given site of definition for the topos. So this means that when you consider subtoposes of the topos of sheaves on a certain side, these correspond exactly to the Grothendieck topologies J prime on C
which contain, which refine the topology J. Very natural thing.
More cover.
Yes, it means that to obtain J prime starting from J, you just add more covering sets. And in fact, already from this remark, you can be more or less convinced about the truth of this result, because here, on one hand, you add more sieves, and on the side of logic, you add more axioms. And in fact, we shall see that adding axioms correspond to adding sieves on the other side. So more precisely, here what we have is that we have a direct bijection between the Grothendieck topologies J, which contain the syntactic topology, and the quotients of T. So how does it work? So imagine that you have a quotient T prime. So here it means that you have added axioms of this form, for instance, to your theory. Now you can go on the other side. So here you have to know what to add to the syntactic topology. And so here you just have to recall that flat, I mean, here we just have Cartesian. So Cartesian JT continuous functors, which yesterday we remarked being the same as the geometric functors from this to any topos E, are the same thing as the models. And this worked in the following way. A model was sent to the functor Fm, which sent any formula, any geometric formula to its interpretation in N. So you observe that this is the same thing as asking this, of course. And then you can consider this monomorphism in the syntactic category. And basically requiring that this is sent by to an isomorphism by the functor Fm precisely amounts to the condition that M should be a model for this additional sequence. And so from this you get the idea of considering the Grothendieck topology generated by all the sieves generated by things of this form. And so this is how one direction is defined. And the other direction, yesterday we observed that we gave the definition of this syntactic topology. So basically, you have a situation of this kind. So if you have, we described how sieves on this syntactic category where, so let's just recall this, and you have this. And so starting from a sieve here, you can build the sequence in the following way. You just take and so by adding all the sequence obtained in this way, you will get your quotient. So I think it is pretty clear how it works. Of course, there are some technical things to make the proof completely rigorous, but...
Olivia, I think you should make the remark that it is not a completely straightforward application of what you did yesterday, because when you go from T to T prime, their syntactic categories as defined yesterday are not the same.
Ah, yes, of course. In the sense that,
so
you see,
not a,
here
it
we
is
represent.
Not a question
you
of
see
topology.
That, no, of course. Here, basically, I change the topology in the sense that I represent the classifying topos of T' prime as sheaves on this. But we also know, by the general construction of classifying topos, that this is also equivalent to to this. So you see that here we have a different category. So, I mean, this is another illustration of the fact that you come all the time with multiple ways of representing topos. In the sense of multiple sites of definition for the same topos. It is very, very easy to generate different possibilities for describing the same topos. Okay,
it's
now,
like describing the same group by different sets of generic.
Exactly. I mean, already Grothendieck made this comparison. He said that if we think about this analogy group toposes, then basically different sets, different sites of definition for one topos are in some sense a sort of analog of different representations for the same group.
So quotients of T just means that you keep this exactly the same.
The same signature. You just add more things over the signature.
The formulas are also in geometric.
Yes, right? always, yes.
So if you do it with the other fragments, you get the...
It's a very good question. It's a very good question that I asked myself, actually, some years ago. And this is very interesting because even if you start, for instance, with a theory that lies in a smaller fragment of geometric logic, there is no intrinsic way of identifying only the subtoposes that correspond to them. So, I mean, there are some invariants. For instance, you can say that a topos is coherent. The notion of coherence was already present in SGA4, and you can prove that a topos is coherent if and only if it is the classifying topos of some coherent theory. But this is the only thing you have, this sort of, and this doesn't allow you to restrict the equivalence given by this duality to those fragments. So this is interesting because it makes appear the fact that really geometric logic is the fragment that corresponds to the geometry of Grothendieck toposes. So it means that if you decide, for instance, to restrict your attention to coherent toposes because maybe you like the axiom of choice and you are assured that they always have enough points, when you perform operations which are as natural as the subtopos construction, as the notion of, you come out of that. So you see, this is an illustration of the fact that really the logic that corresponds to Grothendieck toposes is geometric logic and nothing else. Okay, so now that we have this duality, we can start playing with it, because in the sense that...
Question.
Yes.
When you look at the site of the CT prime, essentially
yes,
you are just adding more errors. The
objects are the same, what changes is the probability, because
so
the probability in T prime, yes, or probability in T.
So
you have less,
more,
yes.
More atoms.
Yes, exactly.
Uh-huh. And essentially the size will be the same, because you are adding a sieve on a certain object, if that sieve is a sequent derivable.
No, you have a different notion of arrow, because it's a different category, and you have a different notion of probability.
But we're receiving the old one in the CTJ.
Ah, for those in the old
CTJ,
one, yes.
You get the sieve in the
yes,
new ones.
But
okay,
have...
so there could be new,
yes, exactly,
new sieves that essentially are covered already by
exactly
the one in
the... Yeah.
What happens if you add contradictory axioms?
Well, you can always do. So in this way, you get a contradictory theory, and this is,
how can it have a model?
No, it has no models. So you have a topos which has no models, no points at all,
okay,
and which is trivial as a topos. I mean, you have a trivial topos. So it's a very important feature of logic, the fact of being able to talk about contradiction, because, I mean, it's not a taboo. I mean, it's important. It's like when one works with imaginaries. I mean, you can add, and then you will see whether it is contradictory or not, but you add. So the message of logic is don't worry, add things, and think later. Yeah.
You say... It has no model, I might object, because
the degenerate topos would be a model.
Model.
Yes.
At least no set-based model.
Zero. That's when usually in logic they say something has no model.
Yeah.
The logician means non-empty model.
Yeah, non-empty. Oh, okay. Yes, of course. Yeah,
that's what they mean.
Yeah, yeah.
But the case of the empty model would be the degenerate topos.
Yeah, of course, if you want. You can treat, you have this degenerate topos and you can really study it as an object, and you can also prove, for instance, that the theory is non-contradictory by showing that the topos is non-degenerate. I did this, for instance, in one of my papers. So I really proved that the topos is non-degenerate. I knew, for instance, that this topos always had enough points, and I was able to deduce that there was at least one point, for instance. So I proved the existence of one set-based model of a theory using the degenerate topos.
For which theory?
Well, it was a theory of homogeneous models for a certain theory of presheaf type. So it was a theory arising in the context of presheaf construction. I will maybe say a bit about this later. Okay, so now let's come back to this duality. So in this duality,
questions. Okay. If the theory is maximal, is complete, what happens to the classifying topos?
Well, if it is complete in the sense of geometric logic, it means that the classifying topos is two-valued. And if this topos is also atomic, which is something important to have, because if you have atomicity or at least boolianness, you can prove that the notion of completeness for geometric logic, which means that any geometric assertion is either provably true or provably false in the theory. This notion becomes equivalent to the first order notion of completeness, which is not generally the case for any geometric theory. And for those theories like that, these are maximal with respect to the natural order of theories that it is induced by this duality. But I will come back to this, because here, of course, the duality gives a lot of things, because at the level of subtoposes, you have many structures that you can consider. In particular, you have the order between subtoposes. You can say one subtopos is included in the other. And so you can wonder what it corresponds to at the level of theories. And so dually, there is an order between theories. You say two theories, one is, well, let's write like this. One is smaller than the other if this is a quotient of that.
It means that everything which is provable in T1 is provable
in T1. Another way of saying it. So we have an order at the level of geometric theories, which are quotients of a given theory, and knowledge of elementary topos theory applied to the lattice of some topos of a given topos tells us that this order is actually a Knighting algebra. This defines a Knighting algebra structure, because at the level of subtoposes you have a co-Knighting algebra structure. So since you reverse the inclusion, we get a Knighting algebra structure here. So it means in particular that you have a join, that you have a meet, etc., between theories. And it turns out that you can even give a very explicit description of what these operations are. You also have this, you have that. And
you get an atomic Knighting algebra, because there are maximal theories.
Yes, you have. You can almost. I mean, it is almost. It is not exactly, but almost, in the sense that for most theories you can find a maximal one that extends it. For most.
So which operations are available on the collection of subtoposes? You say that you have a join and a meet. Do you have infinite meet? I suppose just. Because
You can also take that, of course.
And do you have some kind of complement, or this doesn't make sense?
Yes, yeah, you have this pseudo complement if you want, yes. So, this you always have when you are in a Knighting algebra. So.
And do you have infinite joins also?
Infinite joins? Yes, of course. If you want to take. Here, you, what you do at the level of logic, you just put all the axioms of how do you define the join of two theories? Well, you take the axioms of the first, the axioms of the second, and you put all of them together. So you get certainly a new theory, provided that it is a set. And so yes, you can define it.
Is there a simple example of a geometric theory that does not admit maximal extension?
No, but maybe the. I mean, I didn't think about this problem, but I proved that in many situations I showed how you can get something maximal out of a theory with some properties. But it depends also on which kind of set theoretic assumptions you want to make. Because of, sorry?
Many choices.
Yeah, that's the point. That's the point. I mean, if you want to do things completely constructively, then it can be a problem.
But with choice, you get the maximal point.
No, not even sure. So in many cases, yes, but I mean, I repeat, I haven't really addressed this completely, but I can tell you that in most cases, yes. You get this Ising algebra structure, so of course we have talked about the join, okay, you can take the meet, so this is, you take things that are provable in both separately. And from the fact that you have a co-Ising algebra structure on the lattice of subtoposes of a given topos, you get also some nice properties of this, like... I mean, you have automatically distributivity for these operations, etc. So it's a nice thing to have. And now I don't have the time to write down the specific axiomatizations for these operations, but if you are interested, you can find them in my paper. So this is called the lattices of the theories. For the moment, my aim is not really to talk so much about logic, but mostly about mathematics. I mean, the kind of insight on the concrete mathematical structures that this duality can give. So, for instance, just remaining on briefly on the subject of logic, on the topospheretic side, you have the notion of open subtopos, or the notion of closed subtopos. And these correspond to extensions of this kind. So open subtoposes correspond to adding geometric sentences like that. And the closed subtoposes, which are complements of this, are given by sequence of this kind, always in the empty context, because these are geometric sentences over the language of the field. So you can see it's very, very natural, both at the topospheretic side and at the logical level. Another important construction that you can make in topos theory is the subjection inclusion factorization of a geometric morphism. So what you can do is the following thing. If you have a geometric morphism of toposes, you can always factorize it as a subjection followed by an inclusion, a geometric inclusion of toposes. So a subjection is a geometric morphism such that its inverse image is faithful. So you always have this factorization, it is a general result. So you can look at what it is in the setting of the classifying topos of a theory, because here you have a subtopos. Now, it turns out that this subtopos can be identified as the classifying topos of some theory, which is related, of course, to this geometric morphism. But this geometric morphism, by the universal property of the classifying topos, is the universal, it is the geometric morphism corresponding to a model of the theory T in the topos here, F. And it turns out that this is the classifying topos of the theory of this model. So you see, it's very natural in logic to take all the things, and not just in logic, because we made an application of that even for non-remotives. We used this kind of construction to take the theory of a model, even though we did this in the context of regular logic. Just if you are interested, this is the paper. So Luca will probably mention this in his talk. Some
and so we actually considered the theories of this kind in those papers, and we showed that an appropriate version of the regular syntactic category of this theory yielded something that is equivalent to classical Norrie motifs. So you see, this is just to show that, logic is really not apart from mathematics, so it interacts very, very well with classical mathematical contexts. Sorry?
Your name is no more here. You are allowed to say that now.
Okay, so here we have talked about open subtoposes, and here about closed subtoposes. We have also talked about the logical interpretation of this construction, the subjection inclusion factorization. There are, of course, many other things to say. For instance, there are many constructions that you can make, many important local operators that you can consider on a topos to produce subtoposes. So when you have a topos and you have a universal closure operation on subobjects of E, so this means just that you have things like this. Then you have a corresponding sheaf subtopos of that. And there are some notable universal closure operations that one might want to consider. For instance, you can consider the double negation closure operator. This gives what is called the Booleanization of a topos. So this is called Booleanization of. It is a universal way of making a topos Boolean. And you have many other operations that you can construct.
Sorry, how you construct this subject?
Well, you take for any subobject M, you consider the double negation of that, and the negation is the pseudo complement in the Heiting algebra in which the subobject is. So the subobject, you have an Heiting algebra of subobjects, so you just take this and you take it two times. And so you get something bigger, so it is. So you define it in this way.
You operate in the lattice of
subobjects. So this is one example, but of course there are many more. And I mentioned this just because of the relevance that it has in the context of various natural mathematical theories. There is another construction that I introduced, which apparently is very eccentric. So basically I proved that given a topos, there is always a largest dense subtopos of that satisfying the Morgan's law. Now, I'm not going to explain exactly what it means, but just to show that apparently, you see, here we are talking about the Morgan's law on a topos, so this means that in this Heiting algebras of subobjects, this law holds. And the demorganization is a sort of universal way of making a topos demorgan. And basically, as you can see, here you are doing a completely topos theoretic consideration. So apparently you don't expect that when you look at this thing under the mirror of the duality, you will find meaningful examples in the context of particular mathematical theories. But actually, the reality is the opposite because, for instance, we proved with Peter Johnson that if we take the classifying topos for the theory of fields, so a very simple and natural theory, and we consider the demorganization of it, then this corresponds under the duality to a very natural theory, which is the theory of fields of finite characteristics, which are algebraic over their prime field.
So you see, this is I mentioned this just as an illustration of the fact that even apparently weird and remote constructions that you can make here might give rise to naturally defined mathematical notions. And here, since I have talked about booleanization, what does it give in the context of the same theory? Well, it gives the fields that are moreover algebraically closed. So you see, you get really natural mathematical examples. If we change the theory, because you might think maybe
what is missing from demorganization to Boolean?
No, the demorganization is bigger. So when you take the Booleanization, you get a smaller topos, and this corresponds to taking the fields that are of finite characteristic, which are algebraic over their prime field. And if you want to get the Booleanization, you have to add, moreover, the condition that they are algebraically closed.
But logically speaking, what is the rule that is not satisfied by the demorganization and its?
Well, the law of excluded middle. Because here, this is weaker than the lower excluded middle. The lower excluded middle is this.
Okay, so this is a weakening. Okay.
It is an intermediate logic between intuitionistic logic and classical
logic. But this law does not hold in general? The first law does not hold in general in the Heiting algebra?
No, not at all.
Okay.
No. This is why it really defines an intermediate class of toposes, which are called the Morgan toposes. And so let's just change the theory to show that this fruitfulness for classical mathematical situations is just not completely by chance. It's not peculiar to that particular theory. If you take the theory of linear orders, for instance, the Booleanization gives the theory of dense linear orders without endpoints, which is again a very natural theory. Okay, so this is just to give you an idea of the fact that this correspondence given by the theory of classifying toposes between geometric theories on one end and Grothendieck toposes on the other is actually very, very natural. Now, let me move to the second topic.
Excuse me. When you say that the theory of... You consider the theory of fields as a geometric theory.
Yes.
What do you mean? The usual first order?
No, it is a coherent. It is a, you can formalize the theory of fields within coherent logic. You can do it without changing the signature. You do it in the signature of commutative rings with unit. So it becomes a quotient of the theory of commutative rings with unit. Okay, so now let us talk about theories. Let us talk about a class of theories that is particularly important in topos theory, at least concerning the logical understanding of classifying toposes, is the class of theories of presheaf type, namely the theories that are classified by a presheaf topos. Why are they interesting? Well, simply because since every Grothendieck topos is a subtopos of a presheaf topos, so you can expect every geometric theory to be a quotient of a theory of presheaf type. This is actually true. So basically, theories of presheaf type, you can regard them as the basic building blocks from which you can construct any kind of geometric theory. So in some sense, these are the simplest theories that you might want to consider, and all the others will be given by an addition of axiom to them. So the definition is theory classified by a presheaf topos. So in principle, you don't specify the kind of presheaf topos that you might want, but it turns out that this category here is essentially determined by the theory, in the sense that if, imagine that the P is classified by such a topos. Then let's look at what it says at the level of the set-based models of the theory. Well, it means that they are the flat functors, like that. But this is precisely the end completion of the category C. Why? Because flat functors are just the functors that are filtered colimits of representables. So this is basically the filtered limit, filtered colimit completion of the category C. And it turns out that you can recover C from the end completion by taking so C up to C completion is equivalent to the category of finitely presentable objects of this category. And so it's also finitely presentable objects of of this. So what is a finitely presentable? Yes, I'm going to say. So definition. So, well, I will give it for a model, but it is a general definition. You say that it is finitely presentable when in a category which has filtered colimits, when you consider the HOM functor, the covariant HOM functor, and you require this to preserve filtered colimits. Okay, so this is... So here we have, so this means that when a theory is of preheaf type, it is always classified by this, because if you just take the Cauchy completion of a category, the resulting category of preheafs does not change. So you can directly take this, and this is gives a sort of canonical representation of the classifying topos. Notice that yesterday we have already identified a subclass of the class of theories of preheaf type, namely the Cartesian theories, because we showed, remember, that if T is Cartesian, then you have that the classifying topos is just take the Cartesian syntactic category of the theory, and this is, so you see, it is classified by a preheaf topos, so it is a theory of preheaf type. Now, the interesting thing is that this class is much, much broader than the class of Cartesian theories, because it includes many theories that are even infinitary, so whose syntactic form is completely different from that of Cartesian theories. So I will give just a few examples, so you can consider the theory of linear orders, and for instance, to formalize the notion of linear order, you need a disjunction, because you have to specify that the order is total. So you see, we are no longer in the context of Cartesian logic. Or you can also consider the theory of intervals. By interval, I mean a linear order with bottom and top. And this theory is interesting because it is classified by the topos of simplicial sets, which is, in fact, a preheaf topos. We have many other examples, so the theory of algebraic extensions of a given field. This is an infinitary theory, because if you want to express the algebraicity condition, then you need an infinitary disjunction. You have the theory of lattice order and abelian groups with a strong unit, for instance. The notion of strong unit also requires an infinitary disjunction over the natural numbers. You also have, I mean, Alan Cohn and Katia Constani have used both the cyclic topos that Cohn had introduced in the 80s and the more recent epicyclic topos. These are two preheaf toposes, and one can describe theories of preheaf type classified by these toposes. We did this in a paper entitled Cyclic Theories, if you are just curious to see what it gives. They are relatively simple theories that one can describe, and simple but not Cartesian, which are classified by these important topologies. And so, I mean, this is just to illustrate the fact that, in some sense, this here is a form, a huge class, and so even though apparently, in terms of syntax, they look quite different from each other, they share many properties, because actually you can prove various results about this class of theories. For instance, a very natural question that you can ask about the theories of presheaf type is, what about the classical syntactic notion of finite presentability? Because I can define, you see, normally one in universal algebra, one defines a model to be finitely presented if there is actually a formula that presents this model. While the definition that I gave here is completely semantic. I mean, you just, it's categorical. You work in a category and then you require a norm functor to preserve categorical limits. And you might wonder whether there is a relationship between this syntactic notion of finite presentability and the semantic one. But let's give the definition. So M is said to be finitely presented if there exists a formula always considered in context, a geometric formula in context, such that basically the elements of the interpretation of this formula in any model N are in natural correspondence between the homomorphisms from the model to N. So you see, this is, for those of you who are familiar with free structures, this is a generalization, because in the case of where you have true, you just find the notion of free model. And here we allow any possible geometric formula. So you see, we have this this definition.
What is N?
And apparently there is a significant difference between the two. But immediately you can realize that if a model is finitely presented syntactically in this sense, then it is also finitely presentable. This is quite easy to show, but the converse is by no means straightforward, because imagine that you start from something that is finitely presentable in this semantic sense. It is not a priori clear at all how to find a formula that presents it, and you have no clue to do this. But we have a sort of special method to address this kind of problems, the bridge technique, which suggests us to work with multiple representations of the classifying topos of our theory. And so in the case of theories of presheaf type, this is very nice, because we have on one end the classical syntactic representation of the classifying topos, and on the other end we have this semantic representation. I say semantic because you see the notion of finite representability that I use here is the semantic one, so I use this. And I know that it is correct, because we obtained this description of the classifying topos by using the semantic definition rather than the syntactic one. So I have that. And now I try to play with this. So yeah, I just have and I put op, since if I want to embed this into here, I can do it with the general embedding, but of course it's going to be covariant only if I put the op here. So we want to sort of pass from here to here, Because you see, we start with something, we start with a finite representable model in the semantic sense, and what we want to do is to find something here. You see, here is the formula. So we want to go from there to there, but it doesn't seem feasible to do it directly, because we have no key. So how to do? So we pass through the topos. So we start from M, and we have our unit embedding that allows us to regard M inside the classifying topos. Now, we use the fact that because this is a presheaf topos, the objects of this topos, of this form, they are very special. They are objects that are irreducible. What does it mean, an irreducible object in a topos? Well, it means that whenever you have an epimorphic family,
so you say that A is irreducible. If whenever you have an epimorphic family like this, then the identity on A necessarily factors through one of these arrows. So you see, it is a very, very strong condition. It is not something that, in fact, it is a condition that characterizes exactly the representables up to Cauchy completion, of course. If the category is not Cauchy complete, then you could have a retract of something that also is irreducible without coming from the site. But here, you see, we have a Cauchy complete category. So we know that this is irreducible. Then we can transfer it here. So let's call the object that we get here A. And so what we can do is we know that A is irreducible as well, because of course irreducibility is an invariant. So I can look at it from the other point of view. And what I am very tempted to do, since I really want a formula, well, I don't yet know that A is a formula, but I can certainly cover it with formulas, because every object in a topos of sheaf, this is a general fact, I mean, if you have a topos of sheaves on a site, then if you take all the arrows from the representables, when I say representables, of course, you have to apply the associated sheaf function to these representables, but so I denote it like that, A, J, or C, all the objects of this form, you make C vary, give epimorphic families.
Do you assume it's subcategorical?
No, not at all. No, because you have, this is a consequence of the fact that at the level of the presheaf topos, every object is a colimit of, so you just apply and you get. No, you don't need. It means that I can certainly, and here the things that come from the site, they are just these formulas here. And and since we know that A is irreducible, well, then we have such a factorization. But this implies that this factorization is monic. But it means, therefore, that A is a subobject inside this topos of something coming from the side. And you can easily see that it means that it must come from the site itself, because this category is closed under subobjects in the topos. So we are done. We have found the formula. So you see, in a completely indirect way, and we would have never been able to do it in a direct way. Because you see, here we are really exploiting the geometry of the topos.
What if I had tried to do it by contradiction? I say that there is no such formula, then I keep going and I contradict the fact that...
I don't think it can. I mean, I tried myself before, and then for me it was a big surprise to find this result just by playing with this. Okay. I didn't believe at first, but then I understood that in some sense this is really the right point of view. You see, it's very simple. And sometimes you get... in this way, in a very simple way, you get deep results that even in particular cases you could not prove. So
this shows that the two notions are equivalent, and this is going to be useful now for describing the quotients of the classifying toposes of quotients of theories of presheaf type. And this is useful because, of course, it gives us a way to get more semantic representations of those classifying toposes, because so far we have just syntactic ways of building classifying toposes, which in practice are not very useful unless you are just interested in logic. But the advantage of working with theories of presheaf type is that you can pretend, in some sense, this category of finitely presentable models, you can pretend that it is semantic, even though it is not actually, because, I mean, this correspondence, you can formalize it as an equivalence between this and the full subcategory of the syntactic category on the irreducible formulas. What do I mean by irreducible formula? Well, it is a completely syntactic notion that derives just by the expression of the property of the object corresponding to the formula to be irreducible in the topos at the level of the formula. So basically it means that every J covering sieve on the formula is trivial. So you see, this is a completely syntactic thing. But, sorry, I forgot the O. Of course, this is a UI. So you see, here you can really switch from the syntactic thing to the syntax. And of course, it works in this way. So here you have a formula, and on the other end, you have the model presented by this formula. And conversely, and this is a categorical equivalence. So anyway, you can pretend this to be semantic, and this is important because you see, you can identify finitely presentable models just by using the semantic definition. Usually, this is what one does. One doesn't necessarily care about finding the formula, but for our purposes, it's important to know that there are such formulas because for making certain computations, it is useful. So now we consider quotients of theories of presheaf type. How much are you?
Seven.
So quotients of theories of presheaf type, this is a natural subject to consider because as we have remarked, as any subtopos, as any Grothendieck topos is the subtopos of some presheaf topos, so any geometric theory is a quotient of some theory of presheaf type. So we hope to be able to obtain a semantic representation of the classifying topos of these quotients by starting from the representation, the double representation that we have for the theory of presheaf type. So we start from this, and then what do we do? So we know by the theorem that we proved above that if I have a quotient P prime, well, I will write it here, P prime quotient of T, then it means that I have a subtopos of the classifying topos for that. But now I move here. And I recall that subtoposes of such a topos are just the localizations of this. So it means that and here I have a Grothendieck topology, you see, that I would like to be able to describe explicitly in terms of T prime. And T. basically, I mean, talking about T prime is the same thing as talking about J. But you see that it is not completely clear how to go from one to the other, because you see here the formulas are, so imagine if you have a sequence like that, that you add to you add to T in order to form a T prime. How can you find the Grothendieck topology J starting from this? Well, you reason in the following way. You suppose that these axioms have a particular form, because, I mean, after all, this assures you that there should be a way of presenting T prime in a certain way, since all the sequences that come from J will have a particular form. They will involve these irreducible formulas, necessarily. Because, you see, we are working here, and we are precisely working on the opposite of that. But the opposite of that is precisely that. And maybe we can just write like that to emphasize this point. So here I am, you see, in some sense all the axioms of the theory should be expressible in terms of irreducible formulas. But this is a bit strange, because, I mean, why should this be the case? Well, the reason is that you can cover every formula in the classifying topos of the theory T, which is of presheaf type. You can cover it by irreducible formulas. This is the logical translation of the fact that you can cover every sheaf, I mean every object of the classifying topos, from with things that come from the site. So what does it mean concretely? Well, it means that I can cover in this way. So this is my geometric formula. It means that there exists a JT covering sieve, which is generated by formulas that are T reducible. So I will have my... And cover means, of course, that this entails the disjunction of all this, all this arrow here. And this gives me the key, because in some sense, you see, thanks to this decomposition, what I can suppose is that I can suppose this to be irreducible. Because you see, we are working inside the theory T anyway, because T prime is a quotient. And I can suppose that my secant is something of the form, because here, of course, I can always add that. So I can suppose that I can cover this formula here by irreducibles, but then this formula I can send it to this formula, so it will give a family of irreducibles that go to my formula. So I can suppose that I have a situation like that. Where? Where all these things are arrows from an irreducible formula to our formula, which also is irreducible. And this is the way to make the translation, to calculate J. Because, you see, we can exploit precisely this duality. And so, I mean, concretely, so you see there I have just a sieve basically in the category C T here, and by using that duality this gives me a sieve on the opposite of finitely presentable models of the theory. So I have got a sieve starting from each axiom of my theory, and if I take the Grothendieck topology generated by all these sieves,
well, this will be my Grothendieck topology J. So you see also in this case, it is not straightforward. You cannot do things directly. You have to pass through this sort of decomposition by irreducible formulas. And I want to remark that it is by no means clear, even if you take a particular theory of presheaf type, yes, that you should have this way of decomposing. You see, you don't see. These are things that really are topos magic, in the sense that you don't, even in particular cases, these are not trivial things at all. And it's full of these situations. Topos theory is full of these situations. So, I mean, Grothendieck was really right in thinking that the notion of topos has an immense potential, and in particular the notion of classifying topos adds a lot to it, because the logic allows a very refined analysis of Grothendieck toposes. In fact, even small changes that you can make at the level of the signature of a theory can have a huge impact at the level of the corresponding toposes. So, in some sense, toposes are very sensitive to logic. And so, I mean, we shall see in some examples after the break. And then I will give more examples of bridges of a more sophisticated nature to convince you of the power of this general methodology and of the fact that the toposes can indeed, as Grothendieck was claiming, can indeed act as unifying spaces. Okay, so see you later, I guess, that for now.